Here, let's do that again. Did you guys hear me clap and talk? And
no.
No.
Did you hear me swear?
Yeah.
No.
No swearing?
No.
No. No. Aaron, I'm doing a little clap thing so we can sync audio. Seth, do you want to do yours?
I just did mine.
Why is everyone freezing?
Now he's...
No, Seth's frozen.
What do you mean? Oh, I can hear you guys.
All right, you're back. No, you're not. Back. I don't know. I don't know.
I just did my clap and you said, Seth, do your clap.
Okay. So. There we go. All right, Chris and Pam, clap.
Oh, no, that's going to screw it up. Here we go. All right, we'll use that one.
Perfect. Perfect.
I am looking at my monitor and I do have a little bit of a stash coming in. It's not quite competing with Chris's.
There's something there. There's
but there's something there.
Yeah.
It's coming in.
We were I have to stage where I shave earlier.
Because one comes in thicker than the other.
Oh, yeah.
So I'm on like alternating schedules above and below the the lips.
Yep.
You know how
it
is.
Yep.
Yeah.
Talking to mustache connoisseur here. So
I'm going to Photoshop mustaches for everyone else.
Perfect. Good. That'd be excellent.
Perfect. That'd be perfect. So no one moved during the entire filming
of this. Hopefully we freeze like again.
A Sam Elliott.
Ooh.
Oh, Sam Elliott?
Yeah,
Sam Elliott?
Yeah,
the SE?
Yeah.
Okay.
If you're going to do it.
Yeah. Yeah.
Do it well.
That's perfect.
Aaron, kick us off here, buddy.
I will. Welcome. Welcome to the Photographer Mindset podcast. Dirt and Glass. Let's start right there. Where's the name come
Hello.
From?
Hey, hey.
The name. Well, we were trying to come up with a name years and years ago for
years and years
photography
ago.
Brand. And we started off like a lot of photographers shooting nature, outdoors, always have our cameras on hikes. So I thought, all right, dirt, let's incorporate dirt somehow into it. And glass is actually the old school lens term that I used to use back in the day. I started long, long, long time ago. And yeah, it was just glass was the lens, so dirt and glass.
And thus
there
became,
you go.
Yeah.
And thus became dirt and glass, which a lot of us look up to in the niche of cabin photography and Airbnb photography and getting out in nature into whether it's cozy cottages or tents in the woods. You guys, honestly, I feel like do it best and really hold the bar high and set the standard for, I think, what anyone that's trying to do this is trying to achieve. And I don't mean to, you know, pump you up so early in this podcast, but it really is true. It really is true. I've been in photography for about 5 years, and from the beginning, just kind of getting into that industry, I like doing cabin shoots every once in a while. And you guys have always been sort of what people, I can't tell you how many times people reference your page for what they're looking for, you know, typically like this kind of vibe. And what people are also showing to be like, this is what I hope to aspire to. So having you on the show is really cool. It's probably a long time coming. I've been fans of yours for a long time, both of you, and pleasure to have you on the Photographer Mindset.
Thank you so much.
Honored.
Yeah.
Truly to be here.
Good. And honestly, I think I saw Chris, I don't know if it's your personal page or maybe your music page. And I think that's what hit me as like, oh, this dude's a dude. Like he's a guy that's, he plays guitar too. I play guitar. Like we do photography. Like I don't care. I'm reaching out. And that's another theme. I think that's been on the show a lot, that there's a lot of musical and photography artistic sort of overlap between a lot of our guests. So maybe it just gave me the confidence to be like, oh, he's one of us. We're going to ask him on, He's the guy. He's got guitars hanging everywhere. He's recording stuff. It felt like
I'm just a normal dude.
He's ridiculously talented. I'll say it for him.
Yeah, normal dude that's playing instruments and recording.
He's a humble king.
You can call it obsessive. I mean, that's the problem. When I have a hobby, I turn obsessive over it.
It's true.
These are, you know, photography and audio work were hobbies that turned into careers decades ago. And it was just, and I'm still obsessed and obsessing over perfection. So
to a fault.
I think that's just where it kind of comes down to.
But it works so well. You meet audio people like bands and stuff that have worked with him, and they get so stoked. It's really cool to see.
Thank you.
And this show is not all about Chris, so let's calm down with
talking about him.
I could talk about him all day.
Yeah, that's easy. That's easy to deflect. But we have Pam here, and her handle, Hey Pam Cakes, is kind of the I'm going to say the better half of the duo. No, just kidding. But equally as talented and creating magic together. And I think that's a theme we'll get into also is I feel like you mentioned it in your story is like find your best friend and start business together. And
I just said that last week or the week before. Yeah, I was like life hack.
Yeah. Honestly. Yeah.
Marry your best friend and work together and do everything. Yep. And you can tell in the first 5 minutes that you guys are truly in love and like have a really nice sort of vibe.
Aww, we got definitely.
Yeah, there's a good energy there. There is. So I don't even know where to begin. Maybe Seth can reel me in. He's good at that with the direct questions. But where I would like to begin is kind of a detailed or maybe a very specific question. And it comes from this weekend, me doing a cabin shoot and promising the world. And feeling like I can do X, Y, and Z. What listing shots, lifestyle shots. Yeah, I'll throw the drone up. Yeah, I can get some video for you. And coming away with a lot and a lot of stuff, maybe overdoing it in a sense. And I'm sure that is definitely a theme that you fought with. When to turn it off while you're there on the weekend. What are we getting actually paid for? And what am I, when do we turn it off? And what do we do with necessarily maybe 60 extra wonderful photos or video opportunities? That's no guarantee that they're going to want to purchase. Do we just hold them ransom? Do we give them to be nice? What do we do? A very specific question. I'm curious how you curate your packages and don't bite off more than you can chew. And what are you looking for in terms of a balance between all that you could do in a weekend, or maybe it's, I'm assuming like a 2 day stay or a 3 day stay, all you can do in a 3 day stay and creating a package or a system that feels good for you and good for them and makes it worthwhile.
I'll let you go with this one.
Yeah. Well, I mean, ultimately we treat every single shoot like we're on the clock as soon as we arrive until basically we go to bed on that second night. Cause most of our shoots do take place over two nights. We are on the clock. Therefore every opportunity is an opportunity to capture the right lighting, the right mood, you know, the specific meal that we're preparing at that moment. Cause we really do treat every shoot like, yeah, the whole time is on.
Yeah.
And so the way that we've kind of made it work so that if we overdo it, we're like, this is for us. Cause like ultimately with all these different platforms that we're able to post on now, they might, the owner might not buy video for their package, but they'll certainly see it. And it's more for like, they still benefit from it. And then they can reach out and be like, hey, can I get that? So like, right. But like ultimately, like even over photography, like over taking photos, it's like at the end of the day, like we can go back if we're feeling like a little stale and be like, oh, I totally forgot that I took this photo and like slap a new version of whatever your editing style is at that time. And then you've got like fresh stuff.
Right. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And I mean, the packages that we do offer are within the range of what we can do within the time that we are going to be there. And
right.
even with the extras, you know, other than, and we still make it work if someone is looking for a full video tour.
Yes.
Of the property for YouTube. That's something that it depends on the size of the cabin. If it's a very large cabin, we might have to push it to a 3-night shoot. But we get most of those done in 2 nights, even with the full video tour, which is it's a very chaotic scene.
It is, but it's a lot of fun because like from like as soon as the tires have arrived in the driveway, we're like, what do we got to do? Where are we going to go? What's got the light? What's this? What's that? Boom, boom, boom.
How much, what percent would you say is a dance that you know or you've memorized from when you pull into the driveway? We got to do this first. We got to do this. We got to put our stuff in the, like wherever, whatever it is. How much is it a dance that you repeat, or how much is it like, we know we can improvise. We're a jazz duo. Like we're going into this cabin and we're just going to see what hits us and fill in our deliverables as we go. Is it a mix of both? Or which way do you think you guys lean?
I think it is a mix for sure. The knowns are usually more on the technical side rather than the creative side. The creative stuff, we really wait until we step in or arrive.
We
try not to do too much research.
Yeah, we see the place ahead of time to make sure, like, yes,
aligns.
We would like to work with you.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And then as soon as, like, it's signed, sealed, delivered, and the dates are in the calendar, we're like,
we usually
go blind.
Yeah, we usually won't look at the place. We try to avoid that. We don't want our creativity to be skewed in a direction based on other people's
notions, photos
so the only, and I would say probably the only time we do a little more research, if it is a place that has been shot by a lot of photographers, then we will do a little research to see, all right, well, what angles have we not seen of this place, and what can we do different.
And then other than that, it's just with the changing of the seasons, like the dance changes, like in the wintertime, our downtime is like doubled because sun's out by 4. So like
we're editing.
So like
at 5 o'clock.
But then in the summertime, we're working until 10 o'clock at night.
Right.
And then even then later than that.
Yeah. So.
Right. You throw an astro or any starry photos or whatever. Yeah, it becomes a very long, a straight 3 days, really, a straight 2 days.
Yeah,
you
absolutely.
Leave there. I mean, I just left there. I'm recovering still. I got home on Sunday and it's like, oh, like,
yeah,
it is a whirlwind. And
oh, yeah. Especially to just be able to flop back into a space that doesn't need to be perfectly decorated.
Right.
Yes. Yes, that's true. That is true. I mean, that leads me to another great question. The dance of keeping a place clean while while shooting it is one for the birds. Like is something I could give up immediately. Like if they're like, what's the worst part about this? I'd be like, cooking any food and cleaning a kitchen 100 times perfectly.
Making sure all the dish towels are perfectly right in the back place toilet paper with the meticulous fold.
The meticulous folds on the beds.
Everything and
we've got that down to a science pretty much.
Yeah. I mean,
there's always one bathroom sacrificed. All of our stuff lives in one bathroom.
Right. That gets shot first.
Yeah.
That's usually that. And then, the bedroom that we decide that we'll be using will get shot next and over again as well throughout the stay. But, you know, to get the listing photos before anything is touched, those are usually the two that we start with.
Yeah.
And then other than that, it's kind of, it really depends on the lighting and from there.
Awesome. Well, those were a few of my questions that I couldn't wait to kind of just get out there coming out of it. But let's bring it back to when you guys met and sort of the evolution of Dirt and Glass and your separate accounts. And I'm just curious because I don't know the history, and I guess I'm guessing our guests and our listeners probably don't know exactly either. They know you as a duo, but I'm curious, how long have you been doing this? It struck me, and I connected with the sort of obsession with hobbies. I've been there through a few things, music, golf, photography. Those have been a few of the ones that have gotten my hooks in, or I've gotten my hooks into. So I'm curious sort of your progression, what you guys maybe studied for or planned for in life, thought you were doing, and then here you are, this is what you are doing, or is it partly what you're doing? I'm just curious of sort of the bigger picture of both of you.
Sure.
Yeah. I mean, our story is just kind of cute and very like millennial. We started chatting online after meeting through mutuals many years ago. Yep. And we were both going through breakups, and I noticed he was hiking a lot in my neighborhood. And I was like, oh, if you ever need someone to hike with, you know, like, I'll go hiking with you.
I guess, like, I can.
Yeah, you know, like, I like hiking.
Whatever, though.
If you want to see any cool trails that aren't very popular.
Yeah.
You know, just trying to be, like, silly. But it ended up that, like, we just totally clicked.
Yeah.
Like, so well. Like, beyond just, like, oh, he's cute. Like, we were just like, oh, my God, we have so much of our, like, the deep fabric of who you are as a person aligned.
Right.
And pretty quickly into dating, my mom and I had this thing where I was like, if you want to get to know a person, you go camping with them. So we found this really cool, like, off-grid little step up from a cabin, and he brought his camera along. And that kind of, like, and this was only 2 months into us dating. That is really when it started.
Yeah, this was 2015.
Yeah.
So cool.
And you should take over from there because it's really fun.
Oh. Well, I mean, I was always taking my camera wherever I went forever. We were at this really cool off-grid cabin, and
it was the Milky Way.
Right. We did some astrophotography just because it was out there. It was upstate New York, but Northwestern Catskills.
Cooperstown area.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, outside of Cooperstown.
It's a nice dark sky. Like, you could see the Milky Way. It was my first time. It was really cool. But, like, we also got these really beautiful photos because it was December of the Milky Way with the cabin.
Yeah.
And then also just some really nice interiors, just, like, just for fun, just to, like, post on Facebook for our families to see.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And he got the idea to email the guy who was an artist from the city. And he was like, this, you know, see if he wants to barter these photos that he can use for his listing in exchange for us to go back and stay.
Right.
And mm-hmm. I was like, I didn't even know that was a thing that you could do.
I mean, it really wasn't, but we figured it out. But,
like, just the concept of bartering, right, your services, it's like, oh, wow. Yeah, no, that is a thing that you can do.
Right.
Mm-hmm. So he was super receptive to it. And thus kind of started this idea. We were like, we've got this unique skill set. At the time, it was just him with photography, and we can really turn this into something. Just at that moment, we were like, because we're broke and we want to stay at cool places. Yeah. And so, like, there was, like, another place in Vermont where we did it. We would put the bait out, which is, right, book the place, take the photos, and then reach back out to see if we could get more stays.
Right.
And it worked.
Right. And then, yeah, we basically were like, all right, there could be a career here.
Yeah.
You know,
at the very least, a side hustle.
Right. Mm-hmm. and we knew at least going that route to build a portfolio,
yeah,
would be the smart thing to do.
And we were already using Instagram to just post them on your audio page.
Right, right. Before I went and started the other one. But yeah, so it was kind of, it was less promotion, more just photos for them to, yeah, use however they wish, whether it was listing or just on their own, have, yeah, them.
It was only 6 months after that first one in December 2015 when he was like, I'm thinking we need to start a separate Instagram for this. Yep. What do you think about this and this name?
Yeah.
And it really just, like, we took it so seriously right out the gate. We were like, we've got something here.
And we discussed it prior to starting that Instagram, we both used Instagram a lot on our own personal pages. And we're always seeing, you know, these cabins popping up from time to time, and they were beautiful. And we're like, you know, we know this is something we could photograph just as well. And but everyone was gatekeeping
the locations
where these places were.
Yeah.
Because they were photographers and that was just their work, and they didn't want other photographers.
Even though the places were available on Airbnb for the most part.
Right.
Interesting.
You could find them.
Right. So we definitely
We
saw a connection there and made a decision that this opportunity that's there to not just photograph these places, but then also help promote the location itself to boost bookings just wasn't happening on social media at that time. So that was our, just this could be a thing. Let's try it.
Yeah. And it really took off.
It did. Right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So you guys literally are pretty much the start of this whole trend. I mean, maybe not the exact start, but like the
it's hard to really figure that out. But I'd say like between us and like the Kyle Fendempseys and the KJPs of the world.
Right. Mm-hmm. They were really the only others in the space showcasing
the places and cabins. Really telling people about them.
Yeah. From time to time. Yeah. But it was more of a let's just tell a story versus.
Let's
talk about this place and promote this place.
Yeah.
You know, let's tell you why you might want to stay here. And that was really it.
That's where we found like a new twist on it.
Right. Yeah.
And you said something interesting, which I'm part of we've had cabin shooters on here, and I'm part of a cabin shooting group chat, I guess that's what you call it, like a group chat, and people bounce ideas off. And people talk about a lot the can we stay for free and trade photos? And I've always sort of said, I like what you guys did. Like, I'd rather you pay for the room and build your portfolio and then value your work and value who you are later on. Like,
we knew it would have to be that way. You can't.
And when people ask, that's always our best advice, is to be like, you know, you kind of have to literally pay your way.
Right. Like, right.
Cause like, you can be an amazing photographer, and I mean, there's millions of them, but unfortunately the people need to see what you're capable of and there's in a space.
Right.
And if you don't have that, you have to build up.
Yep. Yeah.
Yeah, for sure. And I think there's a, we talk about it often in a lot of different industries, but this, artists seem to be, I think, more emotional. I'm being stereotypical maybe, but more emotional than business centered people. Right. And the idea of someone liking your art or liking your work is worth a lot. Like someone saying like, I would give you the opportunity to stay at my place for free for a few of your photos because I really like your work, is like, oh yeah, okay. Like we take that very personally in a nice way. But then there's the business side of it where it's like, okay, well they're, whether it's a cabin or a product or whatever it is this is marketing. They're making a lot of money. It's paying their mortgage. It's paying their second home. It's paying whatever it is by your photos. There should be some sort of reciprocal thank you, essentially, for that.
Right.
And I think it's something that this industry fights all over the place. And I mean, you have clothing, you know, companies that are like, we'll give you a jacket for full rights to all your photos, or cabins that might say like, you can stay for free, like we'll trade a stay for stuff, and then they're using the photos for years to book nights. So it's a thing that's going on here. I'm curious if you feel like you have to fight that at this point now a little bit, and feel like there is that competition of the bar being lowered by, like you said, there's lots of photographers now on Instagram that a lot of them have a decent amount of talent too. Mm-hmm. And a lot of them are willing to like, yeah, I'll go stay for free and give you all my, I'll give you 100 photos.
Yeah. Right.
And then you're like, you know, I'll give you 20 really nice photos for X, Y, and Z. And they're like, well, that person said they'll give me 100 for free, you know? So I'm curious if you're fighting any of that or that sort of tide that's going through this industry.
We, knock on wood, we have not experienced the like lowballing like metaphor there. Mm-hmm. I mean, people that'll reach out and be like, I'd love to do an exchange. And we're very honest. We're like, we don't barter. Mm-hmm. We can't barter. This has become a full-time job.
Right.
Back when I was still working full-time, you know, it was different. It'd be mm-hmm. like, you know, if that's what they can give us, then that's, you know, we still want to build. So that's right. what we're going to do. Mm-hmm. But nowadays, we are very quite firm in that regard and have not run into an issue because once we're like, you know, these are our full-time jobs, we're traveling out of state for a lot of this. And they're like, yeah, you know what? That is very valid. So yes, please send me your rates. Like,
yeah. And I mean, we definitely years ago, you know, seeing seeing photographers coming up and trying to do what we were doing, you know, at first it was like, okay, like we got to just stay on course.
Yeah.
I have the studio and have been an audio engineer for, since the early 2000s. And that became a full-time career. And this actually kind of took over, and this is kind of just part-time now, but working for myself for many, many years was a big, big learning experience in the studio. And it translated, and being in bands actually, translated mm-hmm. really well to exactly this situation here, mm-hmm. where, you know, when I got into audio recording, I was, you know, this was reel to reel. ADAT back before home recording was really much of an option or accessible. And I was in it through the flooding of home recording studios. And mm-hmm. I had to kind of battle that through that where, you know, I had artists and bands who were interested in recording with me. But they were like, you know, I can't afford that. And this person says, I'll do mm-hmm. it for free at home, at their home studio. So we're going to go with them. And, you know, it took me a little while, but I learned pretty quickly that, all right, let that happen. You mm-hmm. know, it eventually, if half of them are going to come back.
If it's meant for you. Everything.
Yeah. Yeah.
Because, you know, they, and of course, like, obviously money's that's a big factor for anyone. So if it's out of their budget, of course they're going to go with the one that's cheaper or free. But you may see that result of that.
Right.
And then a year later when you've saved up, come back, you know, and that's where I had to explain that to Pam.
It took me a while.
Yeah. I mean, you didn't work for yourself. And it was literally an experience just learning, you know, working with yourself for yourself, being in bands and starting, you know, doing certain styles that weren't really out there yet. And then seeing other bands coming up and kind of doing the same thing. And it, again, it was just like, you just got to keep moving forward. If you're paying attention to what they're doing too much, you know, it's just going to affect what you're doing negatively. Mm-hmm. And that was, it really just translated almost exactly
to this career. Because at like, the end of the day, like, there's so many cool cabins. There's so many good photographers.
There is so much
room for everybody.
Right. Yep.
Yeah. Yeah. That's something we say often. There's a lot of cake, we call it. There's a lot of cake for everyone.
Yep. And there's a lot of people that value, there are a lot of people that value photography and they don't give a hoot what your follower count is.
No.
Mm-hmm. If they like your style, mm-hmm. they want to work with you. So like it's out there.
Yeah. Yep.
Yeah. And there's a lot of clients that like to spend money. Like these cabins are their investment, their babies, their retirement homes, their family pass downs, you know.
I'll add one little thing to the just this is important, I think.
Yeah.
We worked with the Woods Maine, and she's a perfect example. She's like, I look at you photographers. You are the artists, and your photos are the paintings on my wall. Like, I want to collect that. And there's a lot of people that are starting to be like that. And I think that's good to know.
Yeah. She'll hire different photographers to come and shoot her space because she wants, you know, their work to hang on her wall.
So, yeah, and, I want to make sure that everyone knows that. Yeah. Like,
it's not.
You matter.
You matter. Aw. Pam's nice.
I'm not as nice. No.
No. No. No, you're a musician. Yeah. Oh. Seth, please.
Hi, I still exist, guys. Don't worry. You'll see me typing here. Aaron's lead on this one, so I'm sitting back and I'm waiting my turn patiently to ask the questions.
And it's going to be a zinger. I'm always like, do you guys like photography? And he'll be like, explain your mindset during.
Well, do you want to go in reverse? Do you want to go all the way back to the start of the conversation? We're half hour in here already. Should we go in most recency? Let's go with most recency. So you mentioned how you no longer barter, right? You got into a stage where you no longer need to do that. You've paid your dues. Awesome. So is there a method where you can play hardball? Maybe hardball is not the right word. Where you can be firm. I think that's the term you used. Where you can be firm with your price. If you're a smaller account with not as vast of a portfolio that you guys have, like, is that possible?
I mean, I'd say yes, firm with the price, but you can then offer some extra stuff. So, you know, when we were still working our way through it, that was something, you know, where it's like, look, we really cannot travel there for less than this price.
Yes.
It just doesn't, it wouldn't work. But how about we get you either some extra content while we're there that we wouldn't have, or extra promotion if that was what they're looking for. So for someone who might not have the history or the portfolio, there are ways to negotiate where you're not taking less money, but you can put in a little extra work for them, and maybe that will
sweeten
be
the pot.
Yeah, right. Maybe that'll be the thing that does it.
Yeah, so as opposed to just saying we can't do it and walking away, it's smarter to figure out a way to do it.
Right. Absolutely.
Always be willing to work with someone's budget.
Right, right. I mean, if you can. And again, it's different for everyone. If you can.
Try to. Yeah. Try to meet them where, like, because, like, ultimately, like, everyone deserves to get paid what they want to, like, how they value themselves. So, like, but, like, if you're willing to, like, throw in, like, especially these days with Reels and TikTok and vertical video being such, like, a hot ticket item, just be like, I'll throw in two edited, beautiful vertical videos. And then that's amazing. That's so worth whatever extra that would be.
Right.
Right. Yeah, I think it can be a common tendency to say, well, they didn't want what I offered, so on to the next one.
Yeah.
Right. I mean, and if you're trying to build a business, I mean, you're not going to get there without negotiation.
It's good to be known as being affable.
Yeah.
Like, I worked with them and they worked with me on my budget and I really appreciated, like that's good.
Right.
Yeah.
Word of mouth is huge in this industry.
Yeah.
Like, we hear that all the time. And, like, if you've got a reputation for being super easy to work with, people are like, sign me up.
Right.
I think negotiate is the word you use there, Chris. And I've been, what applies here is one of my favorite sayings is, you don't get what you deserve, you get what you negotiate. I think about that all the time.
Yeah.
Yep. All the time. And I mean, and I guess what you've just mentioned is, it's like a form of an upsell before you even started. Like, hey, let's make this happen some way rather than not at all. How else do you two like to upsell extra content in creative ways after it's been filmed?
Everyone's
We're going back to
right
the start
now.
Of the conversation, but your segue was too, it was too nice of a setup for me to not go this direction.
Lost you there for 30 seconds. Everything was frozen and quiet.
You lost me there?
Yeah.
Seth, I still had you, so maybe just repeat the question and we'll...
Okay, I'll make a time mark for you, Aaron.
Yeah.
You guys mentioned how sometimes you film extra content, right? And you have all this extra stuff. How do you potentially like to upsell that extra content in a creative way? How can people do that?
We post it.
Okay.
That's really like, we post it and they're usually like, I love this.
Okay.
Can I get this? And we're like, absolutely. And we drop it in their Dropbox and the transaction is completed.
Simple.
Yeah, it really does. I mean, usually it's our stories that a lot of that stuff gets posted on.
Yeah, because we'll make videos when we're there, even if they haven't asked for one, just because video just tells a better story in stories. Mm-hmm. And so they'll see that and they'll be like, maybe I do want that.
Right.
And I think this question applies to everybody listening, because not everyone listening is a cabin shooter. But so I'm trying to, you know, also ask questions that are relevant, I think, across the photography industry as a whole.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. If you have the opportunity and the time to do that extra stuff, I mean, like she said, we're on the clock from the minute we arrive until late every night. So we are there working. We're not there relaxing, unfortunately. Yeah, you know, as much as the hosts want us to enjoy and the relax.
Really, really want us to relax.
They do. But please enjoy our space.
Right.
I mean, we enjoy working there.
Yeah. we are just creating.
Right.
There is no downtime. So, you know, when it's like that, I mean, if that's how you approach the job, then it should be pretty easy to, and you are inspired by the space, it should be pretty easy to just keep creating.
Yeah.
You know, that's kind of where we land.
You've mentioned this a couple times that you're on the clock, and I'm curious if mentally you are feeling like you're being paid in a sense of hourly or day's work.
Or frozen again.
Is it more of a formula in terms?
We lost you again there for like 10 seconds.
Sorry. Okay.
The on the clock question.
Yeah. So you've mentioned a couple times that you feel like you're on the clock as soon as you get there. So mentally, do you feel like you are being paid a fair hourly wage for your time there? Or is it a formula that's more complicated based on, let's say, the price per night that they're going to get from this, or down the road sort of investment, or companies, or I don't know whatever else there could be there, but is it sort of like, this is fair hourly rate, we're good, I don't care what the place is? Or is there more that goes involved into finding a price point that makes you guys happy and makes them happy and everyone's happy?
I mean, I think the latter for sure. Like, it's the, you know, a price point that we're happy doing all of that work for, and a price point they're happy hiring us, and whether they realize they're going to see some extra stuff or not. And that on the clock, if there is quote downtime, we are editing the content we just shot. And if you think about it, we would be editing that anyway at home.
Yeah.
Right.
So we're actually just freeing up time when we're at home.
Yeah.
If we're there and we've shot everything we possibly could, or the lighting's just really harsh for the next 3 or 4 hours,
we're editing.
And then again, that's the work that we would be doing anyway.
Yeah.
We're doing it while we're on the road versus, you know,
yeah,
taking and that all home.
It does go into that whole, like, the value of them. They are giving up 1 to 2 nights. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So we want them to be receiving immediate, what's the word I'm looking for? Product, I guess. They instant satisfaction. As soon as, like, within 2 hours of getting there, they're like, okay, I get it. Like, they're here, they're working, they're taking this seriously. We get that a lot. And it's like,
yeah, we are posting edited content in our stories while we're there. It's rarely phone
content. It just makes sense for us to kind of treat it like such a serious job.
Right.
Yeah.
I mean, and the immediacy of seeing the return on investment
immediately
is big. And that, again, going back to my studio work and being in bands before I was in a studio, and I was running a studio and in bands in the studio, I would hate the waiting period after our session was over and not hearing anything that was done that day for however many long, a week or whatever,
yeah,
before you even hear anything rough. And then being in the studio working with bands, it's the same thing. It's like, I want to give them that stuff as soon as possible, even if it's a rough idea of what they did that day. And it's the same thing.
We don't give rough photos. They're getting good photos.
And I say rough, and I'm, again, obsessive. So it's like, it ends up being a little more polished than normal. But
I was literally writing down, how valuable is it to post content while in the middle of an assignment? What are the benefits? So that's so funny.
Yeah.
Right there, return on investment. The client sees it and they're immediately like, oh my God, I love this. This is great. Like the reaction is always like, I can't believe this.
So you're almost building a bit of a halo effect.
I guess so.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
A little bit of excitement. Like, I can't wait to see the whole package.
Yeah.
Right.
And we don't keep them waiting. We have a very quick return, because like that stereotype of waiting for so long, it's like, no, you don't have to. And it helps us too, because the edits are better when the energy of the space is still fresh in our minds.
Absolutely.
Mm-hmm. Agreed. Yep.
Yeah. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And sitting on stuff to edit is never fun.
No.
Because then, you know, you're thinking about, oh, I got piles and piles of stuff.
You've got us elbows deep in the middle of an editing project, too. So you're catching us at a good time.
Yeah. Oh, good. 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 A little break. I am too. I feel you. Question about editing style. You guys have a pretty distinct editing style. People know that they book you and they see your style, they see your portfolio. Does it ever come back where they're like, they want to adjust edits or change your artistic style even a little bit, or like where and how do you deal with that? How do you, is the client always right? Is your artistic style, and that's what you hired? I'm very curious about this, especially with people that I think that have a very distinct style, but people can see that and it works for a certain cabin. And then for theirs, they're like, oh, I want it a little brighter, or I want it more airy, or whatever it may be.
We've run into very few times.
There was one person who didn't understand that the sunset just looked the way that it did that night. We can make it look fantastical.
Right.
Other than that, like, I mean, not if it's happened, it's been a very long time since that's happened.
It rarely happens with hosts that we are hired to shoot their spaces. There's always feedback and edits with working with brands often. And that's known and agreed upon ahead of time as well. But
the other thing was back in the era of Airbnb Plus, was that what it was called? Their luxury, needed photos to be a lot whiter and brighter.
Less moody.
That was the only time that we ran into any issue, was because our editing style at the time was super moody. It's not as anymore, but.
And to the surprise of the host, you know, they wanted, so basically they wanted to use the photos that we captured of their space for Airbnb Plus. Airbnb had said that it was a little too dark and moody. Yeah. So they actually, Airbnb came out, shot the space the way that it would be for Airbnb Plus. They were on it for a month or so, and their bookings dropped so bad that they backed out of it, put our photos back up, and they were back to getting bookings.
And now Airbnb it was Plus really, isn't a thing anymore.
It was definitely something like interesting to learn. Because then we at least had that knowledge, and we at that time when that was becoming a thing,
it
we
was
had people asking us about that, and that was definitely
but that was it.
Did we lose you again?
Oh man,
you guys are frozen again. Hello.
Unless it's us that's frozen.
There you are.
Oh, there we go.
You froze out for a sec.
All right.
Did you lose anything?
We'll never know. That's probably a gem.
It's all right.
We'll just fill it in with fake voices.
Perfect.
Yeah, that'll be perfect. You're an audio engineer. You can dub something
out. I'll figure something out.
saying that Airbnb Plus is no longer a thing. And that was
it's no longer
a thing.
Yeah, we got that.
Yeah.
Cool. Very cool.
What are some of the most important things you two have learned?
Ooh. Most important things we've learned.
Oh, well, the algorithm has no bearings on our worth at all whatsoever, and it doesn't on anybody's.
No, no. Yeah, that's a big one.
That's a huge one.
Just put the content out that you're happy with and just let it do its thing. Yep. I mean, there's no guarantee for anything nowadays with social media. And especially
for photographers, like any photographer, videographer who has integrity in the style that they like to put out, it's not going to be in favor of the almighty algorithmic gods. So if you're happy with it, if you love it, you put it out there, it's a portfolio. People see it and it's worth it always.
Right, right. Yeah. Your feed is a constant updating portfolio.
Yeah.
And that's really
it. Another thing I've learned is a lot of people use the word cabin very liberally.
Okay.
Yes.
Well, what the heck is
Please
a
expand.
Go for
Well, no, just basically like because cabins became so popular, like anybody would buy a home and call it a cabin. And I think that we need to learn words like chalet and chateau and lodge.
Yeah. And home.
And home. Home is okay. Home. It's okay home, if it's home a home. Okay.
It's a house.
It is okay if it is a house on a lake. Don't call it a cabin. Call it a lake house.
Right.
So we've learned that some individuals don't respect the intricacies of the terminology in the field you're in.
Or they're still learning.
Yeah. I think it's just some people just, they don't know. They buy
Is that a
house,
problem or is it just cabin. Annoying?
It's not even annoying. No. It's just kind of silly. I wrote like a dumb little blog post about like what actually is a cabin and people gave me
Please
some
tell
really
us. What is a cabin?
It's just, it needs to have wood. Like you need to have some wood on the walls.
Okay.
There needs to be wood. You can't really, it can't be drywall. Let's be real.
Yeah.
Can you have drywall and wood?
You can, but it can't just be like an all drywall, like home.
You're right, right.
Yeah.
Yeah, you want to have some texture on
fire
the walls.
Fire element, wood stove, fireplace.
Right, like fire element for sure.
Always, you know, a nice, a cozy setting. It can't be cold. The lighting has to be warm.
Right.
That's one thing if you're a cabin owner, if take anything away from this. The warmer the lighting, the better.
Right, yeah.
If you're trying to set a cozy vibe.
Okay, so we lost you there a little bit at the end, which makes it a little clunky and we can't hear. And
it will record what they said though.
Yeah, that's good. And this will be uncut. That's what we like to do on YouTube. So it'll see all our little blunders because no one's perfect.
That's all right.
A question though, in all honesty, because you came very strong with that, the algorithm is not your value. I'm curious if at some point, because between 2015 and now, things have definitely shifted. And was that something that you had to look in the mirror a lot and kind of fight mentally and mindfully with like, Are we getting worse? Is this not a thing anymore? No, I think we're getting better. Our business is like, did you have to get around that sort of thing? Because the almighty algorithm, I think for some people is a little bit, it hurts. It hurts the ego. It can hurt the passion.
Keep dropping out there.
I think it's easier to sometimes get into the passion when you're getting that validation and keep going. That makes sense externally, getting people to like your craft, no matter what it is. So is that something that with that strong statement that you've had to experience and get through?
He hasn't. He's always just been like real easy breezy about it.
Well, you have to just remember that if you know you're putting out
if you're
work,
proud of
that
your
you're
work,
proud. Right, right. You have to just put it out. And
yeah,
and you know,
it took me a while. It took me, I'm not gonna lie, it took me a couple of years because, like, the first real like shift away from like photo centric app to video really kind of rattled a lot of people. Like, we had been doing video, but we were predominantly photo based.
Right.
And like the first time a photo really tanked, I was just like shook to my core, like, oh, I'm clutching my pearls. Like, but like over time, it's really just like, you know, there's a style of content, because I think content's kind of dicey, like,
yeah.
Mm-hmm. But there's a style that's popular, and it's not what was natural to us. Like, I tried to be front facing for like a minute, and I was like, this is the most inauthentic I have ever felt in my life. And I couldn't appease the gods, if you will. So mm-hmm. I was just like, you know what, I'm not gonna do that anymore.
Right.
I'm gonna post, and I'm gonna accept whatever it is, because you have to separate your value from the number, because mm-hmm. people are still reaching out. They still want to talk. They still want to work. And half of them don't even give a damn about a stupid app. They're literally looking for photography.
Right.
Like, they don't live like, you know, Instagram can be, or just social media in general can be a bubble. And you forget that, like, there's so much outside of that that yes. is important.
Right.
Yeah, for sure. And I got to say, it's one of your, I think, most professional and admirable qualities in terms of your work, is there's often a human element, but it's not, it's kind of ghostly, if that makes sense. Like,
we yeah. love that. that's our calling card.
Yeah.
But yeah, I think there's a lot of content we don't do if the space is just too tight.
Yeah, you we know, don't want to be more than it. Like 10 feet away, close to the camera.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, because it's, well, really, it's about, there's been a mix up lately, I think. It's about the cabin or the chalet or the chateau or the house on the lake. That's what it's about. That's what you're getting paid for. It's right. it's not about the model or the photographer. It's about the photography.
Yes.
And you see some of that content, and it might be great for some people, and it might be what people are looking for. But to me, it seems like it's missing the mark. And I've always, I think, looked up to your guys's work in terms of like that element of it. Like, oh, there's people there, but who are they? It could be me. It could yep. be me and my friend, me and whomever,
exactly why we you know, do that.
Yep. And that, I think that sells. And that is the way in my opinion. I do think that's like an interesting point for people to hear and understand when they're hired for photography, to be very clear on the why, like, why are you being hired? Right.
Aaron, we lost you for like 20 seconds.
Oh man.
That's all right. You have the audio. You're talking.
Yeah.
Sorry.
Yeah. Just agree. Be like, no, yeah, you're right.
No, I mean, you, Pam had a, you said that we were kind of like Sims.
Yeah. I treat it like Sims.
Right.
Like yeah. you throw a little, I forget what they call the little plumb bob above the head.
Yeah.
And like, you literally could drop anybody in. Right. Like yes. we try to make it a very like, not us situation.
Right. Right. Yep.
Yeah. It gives a scale. It gives a narrative, and that's as far as you take it. And I think that for any sort of what I was saying was, anytime you're hired for photography, the why is very important. Is the why like, because they want portraits of me? Probably not. The why is probably because they want to sell what they have, right? And the best way to do that, I think, is something that you've keyed into, is like keeping it ambiguous in terms of like, who's there? I don't want to recognize their face, that like I'm going to share the same bed and space that they're in. Right. I've always thought that was weird. So yep. I kind of want this sort of vague narrative of the space, but at the same time, you need that sort of human element. Otherwise, it's a little bit cold sometimes.
Oh, yeah.
Absolutely.
Very much. That's why we definitely sprinkle in about 20% lifestyle into our shoots.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. At least. Yeah.
Because ultimately, that is it looks nicer on the grid for social media, like to just see like a little speck of a human.
But even nowadays for listing photos, it's becoming more and more common as well. So, I mean, originally, it was more geared for them to be able to use on social media if they were lifestyle content. But now
it really helps. It does. It sells a story rather than just a space.
Yeah.
Yeah, and it creates like a unique photo versus like, here's the living room.
Right, right.
Yeah, it's tough to make some living rooms look good. So you, if it's large enough where you can put a person cozied up with tea and a book, like, oh, I can do that there.
Yeah, yeah.
Now, do you guys ever have to go your separate ways and like, I got this cabin on my own? And what is the difference between, or maybe you don't do that, but shooting on your own and being able to have a partner there to, I mean, it's twice the work person to be able to
get stuff done and model. I mean, a lot of people don't know.
Help out and press the shutter.
That you're shooting, because she's shooting as much as I am.
Yeah.
And we have different styles of photography. So,
and we're also capturing different things when we're there.
Right. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, there's, that is a huge plus right there. You know, when it was just me behind the camera,
right.
It was a lot more switching lenses.
That was a lot. That was short lived, because almost immediately I was like, I need a camera. Mm-hmm. I need to do this, like, take it seriously. So like, he started teaching me, like, I had very basic photography knowledge. So he started teaching me and I was just like, all right, hit the ground running. Let's do this. Mm-hmm. Like, you're getting two for the price of one, baby. So that's the way it was. Mm-hmm.
What are the struggles of potentially being married, working together, being in each other's ways? Or is it just like this most harmonious relationship that we've found on this podcast? And
I mean, I'm not going to lie. We friggin' love it.
We
get to spend every day together.
I'm the one that I'm always like, can you just
but like ultimately, like at the end of the day, I'm like, are you kidding me? Like the annoyances at work are nothing what they were when I was a friggin' pastry chef. So I'm just like, sign me up, like every day. Like, we just like make it fun, and like if it's stressful, which it gets stressful, it's just like, hey guy, like this is still really cool.
Yeah,
that's awesome. Well, yeah, you guys have found a winning equation there for sure.
Yeah.
What's your pastry to go? Like, what's your go-to?
Dude, I would, well, we're going to Maine in like a week and a half, and I cannot wait to get my paws on a holy donut. Like, holy donuts are kind of a jam right now.
Yeah.
Really?
The holy donut is the place to go.
If you're in Maine driving through like the southern coast, hit up a holy donut. They're like a little mini chain now.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. And you can order them. Yeah. Worldwide, or at least countrywide.
Yeah, soon.
Oh, God damn it.
There you are.
Okay.
We're back.
It could be, I mean, we're up in the mountains.
Yeah, we got that rural internet.
Yeah, we're going to blame it on you.
Do it.
But that's fine. Question, what is a good rhythm for you guys? Speaking of music, no pun intended, but what's a good rhythm in terms of this career? Is it a shoot every 2 weeks, three a week? When's it get too much? When's it get too much travel? Who's in control of the booking, the trajectory of your travels? Are you all over the place? Do you try to group things in? Do you base it on, we got something in California, let's now reach out in California and try to get four?
It's kind of a mix of a lot of that.
We try to do 2 weeks on at the beginning of the month and then 2 weeks at home to work and just have downtime. Mm-hmm. But like ultimately I'm doing like the, okay, where can we go? Where do we have a lot of form submissions? Like, where are a bunch of places that are close enough of a drive together where it all will make sense, and like proximity to airport too.
Right.
And then we kind of like sit down and chit chat it out, figure it out, like, you know, make it work like months out. And so like, that's how we pretty much know the rest of our year. Starting in the middle of summer, like we've got it figured out. So yeah, it is. It's like, okay, there's this place, just send us a form submission from the Catskills. What else do we have in the Catskills? Okay, we can do three. And like, like we really just kind of, it's a little improv-y, but like there's a system a little bit there.
Yeah. And some months we will either overwork ourselves.
Yeah. We just did that.
or underwork ourselves because we want some extra free time or and we can. But yeah, I mean, we just got back from North Carolina/Tennessee.
Yeah.
But, you know, we knew we could make the most of that trip.
Yep.
You know, we knew we could do 6 shoots in 10 days.
And we did.
That's
I don't know how, but we did it.
That's a lot of nuts. But
yeah. And yeah, without a day off. So it was, that was one for sure. Wow. But yeah, I mean, that we knew we could do it. We've done it before.
Yeah, that's we'll be doing it in December in Colorado too.
Right.
Like,
right.
When we're going away, we try to just like really jam pack because like there's so many people. We want to try to squeeze in as many of them as possible. Right. And it's like, I feel awful when we're like, it's just an hour extra too far and we can't make it work. And like, you know, it's so hard, but you know, we do our best.
Yeah.
And good problem.
It's a good problem to have.
Absolutely. I can't disagree with that.
That's true. I just feel bad because like if we could, we would.
Right.
Yeah,
right.
Of course.
And like I say, we rarely even take time for ourselves when we're out in these areas. And it'll be a day at the end, maybe.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And at
we
that
did
point,
squeeze in one day from a birthday. We were in Pigeon Forge and we went to Dolly Parton Stampede.
Yes, that's awesome.
But we rarely do anything in the local areas. We're like,
but
so
we also
lame.
Worked that whole day.
Nice. Yeah.
That's true.
But if you're flying out and spending money on a car and, you know, it makes sense to do as much work in that one flight back and forth than having to bounce all over the place. I mean, that's your bottom line too. So that totally makes sense.
Yeah.
In balancing your music career with this, I feel like it's hard to be 100% in on both. So now has the recording kind of, you let that come to you when it comes to you, or are you actively searching that out too and planning that? Or
no, I let it come to me.
Most creative friends on the planet, and they all have like 18 bands and they all want really good recording so they can press vinyl and stuff. So like that's when he gets those projects.
Right. So, awesome. I mean, I just got hit up a few days ago from a few friends. And again, you know, they were hoping for the first weekend in October.
I was come on, guys. Boy, you're crazy.
We cannot do
we
that.
We want to record during peak fall. We just feel like the colors help us with that.
So that's now that's going to be in November. But so it's more of just, I'll let it come to me. And it's at this point of a few full albums a year that I'll work on for bands and a few EPs or singles here and there. But yeah, it's more, this is a hobby that I call it a hobby, but also it's a job.
Yeah.
A hobby that you're very, very good at.
That's very
but I
cool.
enjoy it. I mean, it's something I've always enjoyed
it's where we're sitting right now.
Yeah.
Yeah. It nice. Again, I saw those pictures, or you connected it from Dirt and Glass maybe, and then
I shared it
some point, and I was like, oh wow, cool. I do have one. You just mentioned one thing, October, and joking about, you know, the one or two weeks of October. Mm-hmm. Does that become, I mean, supply and demand in terms of people that want you to shoot? We've got maybe 2 weeks.
Who
is it, a bidding war? Do you
know?
Is it like our peak when it Uber comes down hours to where your prices are
choosing
going up because this is like this
they
is
have
high demand?
To be really, really wow. Like they have to be for peak fall. Yeah. It's gotten to that point.
Yeah, yeah. We have to. It's a very selective process.
And
you know, there's factors like. Okay, it obviously has to be a place that's surrounded by trees that would only make the most sense.
It has to be a place that is going to have good fall foliage.
Right.
So like a lot of Vermont, New Hampshire, Maine, obviously.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And Catskills, you know, all the basic Northeast. I mean, gosh, we're so lucky up here. Like it's insane. Mm-hmm. But yeah, no, like we've we're heading into fall this year, having booked everything last year, which last is insane fall. Because like
we usually we
don't do that.
We don't. Yeah, we don't try. We try not to.
Yeah.
Like, we try and be like, unfortunately, we're not booking yet that far out. But yeah. We did this year. Yeah, it was booked a year in advance.
Yeah, so. it's crazy. But yeah, fall's fun around here. Let me tell you.
Yeah. Yeah. Pack it in. And a little bit of a guessing game. When's it going to hit?
Right.
We've got it. I mean, climate change is affecting dramatically. A lot of flooding, a lot of leaves. The leaves are different. I mean, I think that's something. If you're heading to New England this year, just be warned. The foliage might not be popping off like you hope it will.
Or at least when you hope it
will. Or when you hope it will. I mean, you never know. We've got trees that are already changing colors.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
So it could be mid-September, late September fall. It could be like, you never know. But we've got a little bit of a formula to kind of figure it out. Like, we give ourselves a bit of a grace period. We start earlier because, like, at the end of the day, like, we have to make sure we're done before the second week is over.
Or else, like, we're pushing it and we could show up and there'd be no leaves on the trees.
But, yeah.
And that's happened.
Yeah. So,
Right. Well, speaking
play it safe.
Speaking of having things figured out, it's my last question. You perfectly segued into it. You know, I have written down, when you find a formula or a system that works, I feel like you just keep pushing that button. What are some things you feel like you've figured out, and how through repetitions are you two leveraging that discovery to continue to get the outcomes you want? Like, what's something you really feel you've figured out and you're just kind of, you continue to press that button?
I mean, well, logistically, we have a form submission that works really well.
That's something we figured out a long time ago.
Right. And that we've made some minor adjustments to that. But other than that, that's always
changed it. Because like before the discussion of shooting a place even starts, we get to see the listing, we get to see the location, they get to tell a little bit of a love story about their place.
Right.
And so we get to kind of get a feel for it. And I think that's another thing that we've really figured out is like how to really like nail the story that the owners are trying to tell.
Yeah.
Because everybody, like at the end of the day, wants their space to be seen as special.
Right.
And a lot of people have put so much work and love into making such a special and unique place. And we're like, we've figured out how to tell all those different stories.
Right. And that between even our photography styles, you know, her stuff is very intimate. And that's really helpful when it comes to, you know, like storytelling or capturing those little details, you know, that someone did really put a lot of thought into in a space.
Yeah.
And mine is the kind of the grand picture, you know, the big picture.
The eye popping, jaw on the floor. No.
But either way, I mean, so just between our photography styles, once we kind of dialed that in, that has really hasn't changed.
Yeah.
You know the lenses you love to use, and I know the lenses I love to use, and we rarely switch. and it works really well. It always has.
Yeah.
That's nice. That's nice to have a formula, I think, like that. Like just a working partner, a good bass guitar and the dad guitar and the mom guitar.
I'm the bass.
But other than those things,
cool.
I mean,
drive. We've nailed that down.
Oh yeah, you get car sick, so I do all the emails while she's driving.
Nice.
So that's one thing we figured out many years ago.
A perfect match. Yeah, this is
nice.
This is disgusting.
Sorry, everybody. We don't hate each other.
No, it's wonderful. It's great. You can tell you guys have fun. Even just talking about it for an hour, you know, you can tell that you really love it. And I think that's more than half the battle. That's most of it. You got to love what you're doing. You got to love the craziness. It's chaos.
Oh, yeah.
I was just there with a Siberian Husky and my 8-year-old son, like balancing those and trying to get photos. It is crazy. It is absolutely crazy.
Uh-oh.
So I respect what you guys do, and you've been definitely up in terms of
We lost you.
We lost you at Siberian Husky.
I was just gushing about you for like 20 seconds. Again, and you missed it. It's gone. It's gone forever.
You said, yeah, you were just in the thick of it.
Yeah, with a husky dog and a 9-year-old and getting cute father-son dog chalet. I'll use the proper term. Chalet photos. But it is like... Ooh, that can test your patience. That can test your your endurance.
Whenever we've tried to have people on shoots, it never really goes well. Yeah. We just like to stick to the two of us.
Yeah.
Yeah, less is more. I've learned that too. Here's a little tip. If they want, we want to promote a retreat, like that's all we're doing.
Right.
Like that, like we're getting a few photos of a retreat and that's it.
Like nothing else will work with those.
No, because it's going to be destroyed.
Yep. Yep. Yep.
And I mean destroyed in terms of like dishes and towels and this is used, that's used, the pillows are, everything. So I think slimming down and really focusing in and not promising too much is a good thing. Is a good
thing
for sure.
Trying to tell people that they can't lay in their bed until we've taken a photo of it is always a strange thing.
Until ever.
Right, yeah.
Sleep on the floor.
Use the bed.
No, you can come. Bring sleeping bags. Why do we need sleeping bags? Oh, because you won't be using the bed at all. No beds.
Nope.
Thank you for spending your time with us.
Yeah, thanks.
And sharing. Absolutely. We countless references to you through the years and definitely a crew that I look up to and will continue to look up to and look at your work and be inspired and put my own twist on things. But
really appreciate you asking us to be on too.
We really do.
Yeah.
This is awesome.
Cool. Yeah, and we'd like to circle back maybe in a year or so, and we'd like to do that with our guests and just say hi, see how things are going, and we'd love to have you back.
That would be great. Yeah, that would be great.
Yeah, right, so keep it up. Have a wonderful fall. Good luck with everything. And keep the smile and the laughter.
We will.
It's infectious.
We will.
Oh, we will. And you guys too. Have a great fall.
I hope you guys have a great fall.
Yeah. Wherever you travel into, hopefully the foliage follows.
Yeah.
Ooh, that's good.
That's a nice blessing. It's a good blessing to end the show.
Yeah, that's good. I like
write that,
that
down. Write that down for your bands and your friends. That's a good lyric. Right
there. Wherever you're going, I hope the foliage follows you.
That's a Noah Kahan lyric.
Yeah, right it there. Is.
Perfect.
I mean, we are in Vermont.
Yeah.
Amazing.
He's a boy.
Yeah.
All right. Till next time, everybody.
All right. Yeah.
Take care.
See ya. Thank you.